Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of I Quit My Band. How's it going, everybody?
Great.
So good. Evan is down and out today.
I'm roasted, dude. Yeah, dude.
He's out.
You're getting, like, you know, low-end Evan.
Low-end.
That's fine, dude.
Low-T Evan.
Low-T. Yeah.
Well, we're always getting low-T Evan.
Yeah.
Oh.
All right. Yeah, wait till I karate chop this fucking table in half spite.
Well, watch out for the computer, because we know now that if you hit it a little bit, it'll delete one of the
tracks. If you hit it a little bit or fucking kick it.
Like, yeah. It'll just delete a track.
I kicked the computer to see what was going to happen.
Yeah, we did a test.
Nothing happened.
Where I Pat McAfee'd my fucking laptop.
We put our lab coats on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thanks, everyone, for joining. If you're not a subscriber, subscribe to the channel.
There we go.
Follow us on Instagram. Follow us on TikTok. And subscribe to our Patreon page. And if you want to listen to the audio-only episodes or watch them on your phone, through Spotify, you can do that on Spotify. We're on Spotify.
It's pretty sick.
But anyways, you know, R.I.P. O.J. Simpson. You know, he died today.
Yeah.
This is the death of O.J. episode.
Yeah. America's favorite running back,
mm-hmm.
rental car pitch man,
mm-hmm.
Comedic actor,
mm-hmm.
And
father
double homicide committer.
Yeah. Yeah. And father of the Kardashians, some of them.
Yeah, there is like the conspiracy theory.
Yeah, that's what people think. It's pretty wild.
It is. Yeah. I don't have anything to say about OJ.
I don't either. I wasn't a fan.
Yeah. I like Naked Gun.
Much.
I like Naked Gun.
Naked Gun's a great movie. I was not a big fan of The Murders, I would say.
Yeah, much
is kind of where I diverge.
Much better football player than guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
The Murders made it really hard to.
I mean, his physical
comedy
in the opening scene of Naked Gun,
yeah.
where he's like, you know, like he burns his hand mm-hmm. and then gets the wet paint on him, closes his hand. Hilarious. The Murders.
The Murders are tough.
The physical comedy of The Murders
was not as good.
It's, they're tough to really look past in the canonical, like. When we take a 1,000-foot view at OJ's life, the murders take over everything.
Yeah, they kind of leave a taint on the whole legacy.
I think that's what he'll be known for, which is sad.
You think?
You know,
that's sad.
Not
it's
the 2,000-yard season.
It's sad that he
season.
Will be known for that.
Oh, yeah, really sad.
It's sad that he ruined everything.
I'm sure the Goldman family is like, it's just so sad
it's
that
so
his legacy
sad
was tainted.
Yeah. Yeah,
from the murders.
Yeah, we lost a murderer today.
We lost a murderer today.
World champion murderer.
It was wild though. Just for a while, he would just be on Twitter, like on the golf course.
Yeah.
Hey, everybody, it's OJ. Yeah.
And remember, don't ask me about it. Like just stuff like that.
And like he had like crazy quotes where it was like, "No, I don't want to go to LA because I feel like the killer might just. I could be sitting next to the killer.
I don't want to.
There's a fucking mirror in the restaurant.
I could be sitting right next to him.
He's like, "Hey, New England Patriots. You know, quit deflating them footballs. That's not good.
Yeah.
And then we're like, what?
Yeah. Okay.
It's insane.
It's nuts, dude. We live in a society.
We do. R.I.P., dude. But anyways.
Not really.
We're back. We haven't done the podcast. We haven't recorded in like 2 weeks.
Yeah.
We did the...
Online, we haven't missed a beat.
We have not missed a beat because we're smart. We know what we're doing.
Yeah.
We recorded with Jake Kelly, A Feeble Little Horse.
Rock
thanks,
on.
Thanks to Jake for coming on the show.
Gonna be playing Coachella.
Yeah,
in like a month.
Soon.
Such a humble guy.
Yeah.
It was like he almost didn't even want to tell us he was playing at Coachella.
Yeah.
Well, because he knows that our bands are like,
yeah,
our bands are playing Coach Ron's Barbecue, my baseball coach from high school.
Yeah.
I am playing Coach Ron's Barbecue.
Yeah, so they're very similar.
And Jake
would
just be like, that's awesome.
That's so good.
He's like, that's almost as good as the gigs I have.
Yeah,
almost. Yeah, thanks to Jake for coming on the show, and
thanks to Liquid Death.
Thanks to Liquid Death, of course. This is the new flavor.
Rest in peace.
I don't have anything.
Yeah,
to
you
say.
Didn't have a bit this time. Yeah, I didn't think so. I saw you reach in the bag.
I didn't want to do the pee again.
I knew that's where you were going.
Yeah,
rest in pee is good.
Rest in pee.
I don't know. They put the drip on the pee flavored ones.
Yeah.
But anyway, we also did the. Songs for the Deaf episode.
Classic
that was good.
For
our first classic review. People seem to like that one. So, you know, we'll do some
look
more
out
of
for
that.
It. Yeah. We liked
yeah.
it.
We
and
had
the masses
fun.
liked it.
We had fun doing it.
It's great that we did one just so ingrained in your childhood that you had forgot that we were even going to record it. Yeah. And you were like, oh,
yeah, you're like, we're doing that tonight, right? I was like, oh. I'm already ready, dude.
Cool. Exactly.
We're going to have a full-ass conversation about it.
Yeah.
I saw George Clanton on Tuesday in concert.
That. Was that at Club Cafe?
It was at Spirit.
Oh, okay.
He is one of the best performers I've ever seen.
Wow.
That like, good?
He, I mean... The show is, it's minimal. It's just him and a drummer and just his lights and, you know, backing track and, like, he has a control pad and
his
stuff.
His lights looked really fucking
his
cool.
His lights are crazy. But it was, like, there was a ton of people there and people were, you know, it was just kind of like people in the front were moshing for a little bit. But by the end of the night, like, the entire room was going nuts. And me, it was out of the point where, like, he was playing his encore and, like, me and Annie, like, we're about to leave like halfway through the encore. Like, let's just get out of here before the crowd, you know, comes out. And we walk over to like the door and he was like on the edge of the stage, like kind of like hugging one of the monitors or the speakers and like kind of by the door and like no one was leaving. So we're like, we can't leave. He's going to say something about it. Like he was like making fun of the crowd the entire night. So it was like, if we were to leave, it would have been like a, people would have noticed because everyone was just going that crazy. I mean, he had everyone eating out of the palm of his hand by the end of the night. It was
except
really
for you,
sick.
Who was ready to leave.
I was ready to leave. It was a late night for Tuesday. It was a Tuesday.
Ooh,
Tuesday.
Yikes!
Yeah.
Who opened Body Two?
Full Body
Two. Full Body
Two. Yeah, okay. They are like a shoegaze type of band. They sound. They have a lot of similar sounds as Feeble to Horse. Honestly, they reminded me a lot of them.
I think that they might have played together at some point.
Probably they have similar sounds. Are they they're just a little bit heavier.
Local thing, or were they on tour with them?
They're on tour with
them.
Okay. Yeah.
Cool.
But yeah, it was a great show. Shout out to George Clanton. He was pretty hilarious as well. He was making fun of people in the crowd. Just
and you were just afraid to get roasted.
Yeah,
so
dude.
You stayed for an extra half hour.
We got to the door and it was just one of those. Annie just turned to me. She was like, "Well, we can't leave now." And I was like, "Yeah, we really can't."
You try to find a back exit and set off like some fire alarm.
Whoa!
Hey, there's the real
stop
loser.
The music. Yeah. Yeah, no, it was great. It was great. Shout out to George, dude. We're big fans of George on the show.
Shout out to George, friend of this, friends of the
friends
program.
Of the show,
friend of the
podcast. And thanks everyone for getting us to over 400 subs. I think that's pretty cool. Hell yeah!
In like basically a year.
Yeah, I mean we were at like 250, a little over 250 at the year.
Oh
and now
really?
We're at like
that's nice.
Over 400, which. Pretty sick.
That's a nice line graph.
Yeah, I'm excited to get to the 500 mark, to the 500 club.
Should we
retire then?
Yeah, we're going to retire.
Should we do something special for 500?
Yeah, we should do something special for 500.
Okay.
Yeah, start selling merch.
Ooh.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, just all 500 subscriber themed merch.
Yes, dude. Just we give a special printed t-shirt to all of our subscribers with their name on it.
Yeah.
Because we can do that.
Mm-hmm.
We can call everyone personally.
Yeah, so. Deliver them to their homes.
If we had the time, we could do it.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're going to start selling merch for our 500, for the anniversary.
The 500 club.
500.
Get Pat Robertson's head on there and just say the 500 club.
Yeah. And Roddy
That's
Radke.
That's so funny. But anyways, we got another playlist for you. We're going to be doing another regular episode this week. We got quite the collection of music, quite the collection of shitty songs that came out this week. I'm so excited to talk about them. I think everyone is.
I'm stoked.
Clearly.
I'm stoked.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, let's just get into it. It's I Quit My Band. This is...
You?
This is me.
Nice.
The return of Imagine Dragons.
The Kings.
Yeah, the Kings. The Kings are back, and it's not the Kings of Leon this time. It's closely related band, Imagine Dragons.
Yeah, very similar.
A very
style
vibe, dude.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I just love the, like, it's the swag, it's swag rock.
Get
it's
ready
still
for this
the swag rock.
To be the intro sequence for, like, every NBA game and every car commercial, splattering paint.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Every intro to any video.
Yeah.
Well, it was the highlight package for WrestleMania.
Was it?
Yes. There we go. I knew this sounded familiar.
Right before the main event.
Yeah.
Like the biggest main event they've ever done. I'm watching. I'm getting all hyped up, and it's this fucking song.
Yeah.
And that was the moment.
Hell yeah, dude.
And that was the moment where I go, I actually like this.
Now, yeah, people were asking me. We were at the Bottle Rocket on Friday night, mm-hmm. and they're like, "Are you guys gonna talk about the? What'd you guys actually think of the Imagine Dragons song?" I was like, "I loved it.
Well,
I thought it was great."
When we were discussing putting together this playlist, it was one. I think it was you that sent a really hilarious text. That was like, so, what did you say specifically?
Like, we were talking about like maybe talking about something that was good, and then we're like, actually, no, we can't. We gotta talk about Five Finger Death Punch and Imagine Dragons. So duty calls.
Duty yeah, calls. Exactly. So I screenshotted it and put it on my Instagram story because I was like, yep,
duty calls. Duty dude. Calls. Duty's calling.
We're really like. You know, doing a service for mm-hmm. the people out there. If yeah. not us doing it, who is?
Yeah, who's going to talk truly. About this in a positive way?
Yeah.
You know?
Because, yeah, I mean, compared to some of the stuff that I've heard post-Radioactive, this is definitely better than that stuff.
It's better than Radioactive, for sure.
You have to get over the fact that they're like, if Linkin Park were formed at a megachurch. That is yeah. kind of the vibe of Imagine Dragons. And if you can get there over that... Which I can't.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, how could you? I mean, that. Have you seen that dude on stage? He looks like a youth
like.
Pastor.
Yeah, and now he's yeah. jacked.
He's jacked, but youth pastors are jacked.
Yeah, they are.
That's
yeah.
what they do. They get jacked. They get the haircut. They look yeah. real cool. And you're like, wow, that guy is cool. And then he's like, you don't like Jesus? Yeah,
like, you know how I got jacked? The Lord.
You don't like Jesus?
Yeah.
You like Jesus, dude?
V-shred?
Get out of here, bro.
People that don't like Jesus get yeah. fat.
Yeah, they fucking, they'll throw Jesus in your face.
Yeah. Yeah.
They'll make you feel bad about not liking Jesus. Yeah.
We've shown as the three of us that we all have the capability of getting over, like, the inherent cheesy embarrassment of a song, seeing it for what it is.
Yeah.
You know,
a beautiful gem.
Yes. And that's happened to me for many things, but I struggle with Imagine Dragons too. Because it's like, it's always like the guy's fucking voice. I'm about to do
yeah.
fair.
Yeah. I mean, I will say I didn't think this was the worst song I've ever heard. I think there's worse songs on this playlist, actually.
Oh, yeah.
There's way worse songs
way
on this playlist.
Worse.
It's not terrible. It doesn't sound bad, you know? It has a vibe to it.
Yeah.
It's better than Radioactive. It's better than Landing in the Thunder. Remember that yeah. one?
Oh, that was really so bad.
Believe is really bad.
Yeah.
It seems like they're going a little bit more edgy, honestly. A
little bit. A little more rap, a little more swag.
They can do this shit with their eyes closed.
Yeah. And when it was on the WrestleMania, it did push it to the edge. Because, I mean, it joins, like, other WrestleMania hype yeah. package songs. It joins Limp Bizkit's My Way.
Hell yeah. yeah.
Ladies Love and it. Gentlemen by Saliva.
Oh, that was mm-hmm. the PS3 song.
Dude, 100%. Yeah. Tear Away by Drowning Pool.
Cool.
Oh, hell yeah.
And Light It Up by Rev Theory.
How about Fall Out Boy's Light It Up?
I don't know. I don't know if they ever made... Well, yeah. I actually have never heard of Rev Theory.
Rev Theory. I think I remember their logo, and it just looks like a car company.
Oh, hell yeah.
Rev Theory.
Yeah, me and Evan...
Our theory is you gotta rev that engine, dude. Yeah, dude.
Evan and I and other white trash across the country had a big weekend this past weekend. Dude,
yeah,
at
you guys, I was talking was to you guys about it on Friday.
Holy
like,
week.
Stone Cold's coming.
Yeah, and he didn't.
Of course.
I looked like an asshole in front of my dad.
The Undertaker did, though.
Did he really? The
Yeah, and John Cena. But anyways, no.
And, like, Undertaker didn't wear any of his, like, Undertaker shit.
No,
he looked like a cat burglar. Like, he had, like a black beanie on yeah. with just, like, a hooded sweatshirt.
I'm just picturing the Undertaker in, like, the Halle Berry Catwoman outfit, like, the bra.
But,
his junk is just, like, so visible and, like,
the panties.
Yeah. The Michelle Pfeiffer outfit.
His ass later. Out.
Just, like, like, he turns around and it's so split down the back. Yeah. And you see his ass and just back and shit.
Hairy ass.
But no, the weird phenomenon about WrestleMania this year particularly is like during the whole show both days was this random weekend song, which was so unfitting to me of
the
like
weekend.
Wrestling. Like,
I
yeah.
think he's had like the last like 3 or 4 years of
yeah,
song on
it's
WrestleMania.
Just like, and
maybe he's just a mark.
He's a huge fan.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe I'm full of shit, but that just it doesn't
Is he Canadian?
I don't know. Why do you?
I don't know.
Think that?
Okay. Just Canadian dudes love wrestling. Bret Hart and shit.
Oh, you know? I see. Yeah, I don't know. That seemed weird. But the Imagine Dragons tunes fits like a glove.
Oh yeah. It's perfect.
Yeah, it's like elevated white trash.
Yeah,
where
yeah.
Like, I'm actually cool white trash.
Yeah,
you know? It would make if I saw it in a WrestleMania video, I'd be like, okay, that song's actually kind of badass.
The Weeknd one, listening not to it, so much.
Listening to it on your own, like you know, for leisure is. That's lame.
That's weird.
I need the Intercontinental title thrown in.
Yeah.
I need a couple chair shots to the head. That's really what sells
some
it.
Some jump cuts. Yeah. Like some.
They should release the song with like B-roll footage of guys getting into fights.
Taking bumps.
Like, here it is. You know? Yeah. But that's Imagine Dragons with eyes closed. Go check it out if you like, you know, Linkin Park and Megachurch. That's it. Let's move on.
This is my first pick. This is Modest Mouse. A remix of their song Bukowski by John Congleton and Chris Godby. They just released the 20th anniversary of their album Good News for People Who Love Bad News. It's like their breakthrough album. And they included a bunch of remixes and wanted to include this one on. I love this song. It's one of my favorite songs on the record. But I thought it was cool because John Congleton was like an engineer on the original version.
Oh, was he?
Oh, that's so cool. Went back and remixed the song. I mean, I love this album. It's not my favorite Modest Mouse album, but what I like about it is like, it's a perfect entry point into a band.
Yes.
Like, there are certain bands that have that record where it's not their best, but it's when, like, their sound was able to become accessible to the masses. I remember I went over to my friend's house, and his stepbrother was listening to this, like, the week it came out.
Yeah.
And I had just heard Float On.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, hey, man, do you mind if I check out that record?
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, yeah, it's good. It's not as good as their old stuff. And it, like, exploded my mind because I was like, I just thought when I saw a band on VH1 for the
it
first
was
time.
Their first. I thought the same thing about everything.
So I was like, what do you mean there's old shit?
This has to be their first record.
When you're a VH1 You Oughta Know artist, when that's like your first thing you've ever done.
When you're following the You Oughta Know artist.
Yeah.
There's like the VH1 Farm Club with just a bunch of bands. They're listening.
Triple A VH1.
Yeah.
Come on.
VH2.
So yeah, hearing this song again in like a really weird version of it, like very stripped down, minimalist, really makes me appreciate how weird Isaac Brock's vocals are.
Yeah.
And like at this time, I think this is probably the best his voice was, where he could still do all the weird shit that he did on the old albums, but he has like a better singing voice as well.
Yeah, I like this version of it a lot. It made me realize like how long ago I've listened to just Modest Mouse in general, because this was one of my favorite Modest Mouse songs when I was like really into them, and it's a weird song on its own, but then just the remix makes it so much like, I don't know, makes it so much more like mischievous. Makes me think of like A Clockwork Orange almost. Exactly. I mean the original one does too.
You're about
but
to
this
stomp
like,
a bum in a tunnel.
This one seems a little bit more, you know, thievish.
The other one has like banjo and like accordion and shit.
Yeah, the other one's sick. But yeah, this is like, I mean, it's basically the same song. The vibe hasn't changed. It's just the instrumentation makes it a little bit weirder, which I liked. That was cool.
John Congleton's a genius. I've liked so many things that he's done. Yeah. I was intro'd to him through his work with St. Vincent. But the spin he puts on this song is like, this time around is really cool. I didn't know that he was associated with it originally. That's and that kind of makes sense because he has a more intimate understanding of like the song or something. And yeah, it's cool. I'm not like very well versed in this band, but I get what you're saying. It's definitely like a gateway drug.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is like a perfect summer album.
Yeah,
which like it has like these like breezy, airy vibes, which is. I mean, half of the songs are about dying, though.
Float On.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Float On.
Float On.
Like, it's unbelievable that they had a song that big.
I know. It is crazy. For a band like them, who probably, like, never would think that for themselves.
Literally,
ever. Yeah. And probably consider it their worst song. Yeah. Like, fuck that song.
When I saw them, I've seen them, like, six times. I've seen them play Float On once.
Yeah.
And he literally said, he's like, everybody likes this song, and I don't know why.
Yeah, no. He said when I saw them, and they did the same. They played Float On second.
Yeah,
it was the second song in their set. And I think he was just like, "All right, let's get this one over with." And they played it like fast, and I was like, I didn't even get to like enjoy it. Yeah, yeah, it was just over. Like they all looked upset. Yeah. I was like, fuck.
We hate this.
I would love a smash hit that's just an albatross on me all day.
Cherry pie, dude. Oh, dude. I'm the cherry pie guy.
I'm the float on guy.
I'm the float on guy.
That's what this podcast is for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's just it's a booming success. Me, and I'm like, fuck.
Yeah.
Every
people
Tuesday.
Come up to me. They just want me to riff.
Dude, it was. Yeah.
What'd you think of the new Imagine Dragons?
It's pretty funny, right?
Oh, shut up. Yeah. No, we don't think that way.
Going to the show on Friday night was the first time I've been around like people in a while. Like the people that like we know. Yeah. And like everyone did have something to say about the podcast. And I was like, stop. Stop.
I'm ashamed of it. You understand?
It wasn't like a stop, but you know, come on. It was like, it's just, no, I don't want to talk about
it. I just like seeing the numbers on the YouTube screen. I don't want to actually think of a human being
about it. Yeah.
Having that.
I don't want anyone to know it exists. I just want to check my phone and be like, we're actually good at this. That's all I want, dude. Let's move on. That's Bukowski, Modest Mouse, the John Congleton remix.
Yeah, this is my first edition. This is Krungbin, and the song's called "Hold Me Up." Parentheses, thank you. And Krungbin is a band that was introduced to me by my dear buddy Benito, who has a very eclectic and interesting taste in music. And he was like, "Dude, they're coming to town. You gotta see them." And I'm like, "I don't know. This isn't quite my vibe." And tickets were kind of expensive, but he's like, dude, let's do it. It'll be fun, you know, whatever. And so I went to the show, because this is totally not my thing. It's, like, just vibe central. And it's, like, so boring. And so I went to the show.
Your face just...
I went to the show, and I don't know what it was about it. Maybe it was, like, most of the Pink Whitney that I drank that I went to the show with. But...
A little rosé. Had me feeling gay.
It was, the whole experience, it was like, I was like, my mouth was hanging open and there was like, you know, cool people everywhere and stuff. And so I was excited for this new album and like, you know, if you know anything about them, they're like the chillest, basically instrumental band ever. It's like basically background music, but there's something about it that makes it a little bit more than just elevator music. And somehow with this new album, it got chiller. And I'm not sure if I'm into it, but whatever. And I'm going to go see them in Cleveland in a few months, and it's going to be amazing. And that's pretty much it. I feel like neither of you guys will even remotely like this.
You know, when you said it's a little bit better than elevator music... I'm having trouble making the connection.
I would say it's tastefully boring.
It's tastefully boring. I mean, I've been on this show before and been like, here's Kurt Vile. The song sucks and it's boring, but I love it. So I understand.
Yeah. It's just the vibes of this shit. And the bass player is really pretty. And, you know, so that's cool. Laura Lee, follow her on Instagram. You know,
I saw them live once. I saw them on... I saw them at Pitchfork.
You couldn't torture that information out of me, and you're just like, hey.
She's really pretty. I follow her on Instagram, and I message her every day to say, hi. Hi, Laura. Hi, do you know me yet?
I'm talking about you on our podcast. It's going to go great.
The guy from the crowd in Pittsburgh that was hammered.
Did you see me in the crowd in Pittsburgh?
I was drooling.
I was the one bald guy.
Yeah, I was the one removed.
I was the one removed for trying to climb on stage. But yeah, I saw them live once.
Did you?
It was kind of one of those situations where like we were going to Pitchfork Festival and like there was bands I knew, bands I liked on the lineup, and then there was bands I knew.
Yeah.
And then there was bands I didn't know at all, and Krungbin was one of the ones I knew. And I was like, Krungbin, we can go see them. And then I go see them and I'm like, oh, yeah, I don't like this at all. Like, I just know who they are.
They're really trendy.
Yeah, like, they're trendy. I didn't know they were trendy.
They're huge.
There's always, like, weird things. Like, people are just into this weird genre of music that I'm like, how is this the most popular
thing? I don't think people actually like this.
I think people just like
it. I'm not sure I actually like
it. No, I think people like vibe. Like, if we are living in a time of vibes, mm-hmm. it's like now.
Yeah.
You know, where
yeah.
like people just like a mood or an yeah. aesthetic or yeah. a feeling.
Study, and chill music.
Yeah. yeah.
I mean, if I'm sitting around at like my house having like some sort of like really interesting conversation with close friends, but I don't want it to be totally silent, put on a fucking Krungbin you yeah. know, album, yeah. you know? Yeah. Dude, vibe central.
Yeah. That's how I feel about Kurt Vile.
Yeah.
And it's funny.
That's how I feel about Significant Other by Limp Bizkit.
yeah, dude. That's yeah. my favorite chill album.
Roll it.
I'm usually a guy that is like super into like in your face stuff. So yeah. it's like super out of pocket for me to even remotely consider this interesting.
And yeah. when I say tasteful, I do mean it. Like yeah. the drummer's obviously very good.
Yeah.
The rhythm section in general. Like
yeah.
they have like a cool yeah. mood or vibe. But yeah, I just like, I don't know. Just not yeah. my deal.
I've tried to get into Krungbin. I have before in the past. Like, they had, like, you know, KEXP sessions
yeah.
that I enjoyed. And then, like, I go to turn on their music, and it just never clicked for some reason. And then people started getting really into them, and I was just always like,
yeah.
why? I don't get it.
They have, like, a super international flair. Mm-hmm. They're from, actually, I think they're from Houston, Texas, or
are
something.
Are they wearing
like
wigs?
Yeah, the Laura Lee and the guitar player are.
They
yeah.
wear wigs.
They wear wigs.
Okay. I thought it was their real hair.
No, they're like mega into like international shit. Krungbin is like a Thai word for like paper airplane or something.
A
yeah,
Thai
yeah,
word for wearing a wig.
Wearing a wig.
I didn't realize like you've said Krungbin on the podcast.
Yeah.
yeah.
Like a lot.
Yeah.
And I've seen the name of this band so many times, and I had no idea yeah. how to pronounce it. Yeah. So I never put two and two together
yeah.
that you were talking yeah. about this word that I've seen a lot of it.
yeah. Oh, this word.
Yeah.
The Thai
yeah.
word for paper airplane. Paper airplane. the Thai word for tastefully boring.
Tastefully,
I could be
yeah.
totally full of yeah. shit on that, but I'm pretty sure that's what it means.
It would be funny if it was the Thai word for tastefully boring.
Because like you hear Krungbin, and I think like one of like the crazy fuzz rock bands.
Oh,
that
for
you
sure.
Think, we're Krungbin.
That's
dude.
What I thought it was.
Yeah.
When like I first saw Krung, I was like, well, these guys got guitars and wigs. They're going to be
sick. Yeah, they're
going to
be sick.
And then they're just like, just a girl at Coachella.
yeah. It's like this kind of music.
Yeah.
You do this to
yeah.
it.
Wearing the flower crown.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like mm-hmm. midsummer, about to catch your boyfriend on fire.
yeah, dude. That's yeah. what she was listening to when she did that. Some mm-hmm. Krungbin. Mm-hmm. That's Hold Me Up, parentheses, Thank You, by Krungbin. Let's move on. This is one I put on. It's a song called Fried 4 by Wine Lips. I remember seeing Wine Lips like a year or two ago.
Me too.
Kind of when I was phasing out of liking psych rock and garage rock a little bit.
Yeah.
And then checking out their album, the last album they put out, and being like, this actually kind of kicks ass. You know, like, if there's one band that could maybe get me back into this, it would be that. Because I saw some live performances of them. Really high energy. Really cool.
Yep.
I mean, they sound like a lot of other bands, but they had a certain intensity about them. And I felt like this did, too. I felt like this was pretty badass. Like, I don't know. I feel like Wine Lips should be on the radar of anyone that likes King Giz or the OCs or Frankie and the Witch Fingers. It's not too much different than that, but mm-hmm. I feel like it has more of a punk garage rock vibe than anything else.
I'm so with you. These guys are like have been packaged and sent to me so many times by Spotify's algorithm.
Hell yeah.
After shit
it's
that
one
I'm
of those
listening
algorithm
to.
Bands.
They're an like, algorithm yeah. band.
You're gonna love it.
Yeah, and I agree with you. This I guess this is this off a new album or something.
Yeah, they just put out this new album.
If you didn't put something on, I was going to because I've been meaning to talk about these guys because they're cool. They're not to me. They're not. This sounds like an insult. They're not doing anything different at
yeah,
all.
No.
But like whatever.
I will say the thing that they're doing different is just maybe being a little bit dirtier personality wise.
Yeah.
Like it's not about it doesn't seem like it's about wizards.
Yeah, which is tight.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
it's like
tight.
They have this album called their new album's called Super Mega Ultra. But,
cool.
you know, there's no mentions of wizards.
Yeah.
Which is nice.
That's refreshing.
It is a nice change of pace.
Yeah,
refreshing.
I like that.
Yeah, because a lot of the fuzz rock stuff does just kind of blend together
yeah.
for me.
Yeah.
And the mode of fuzz rock that I enjoy more is like the faster,
yeah.
surfier, punkier stuff. So
yeah.
I really enjoyed this. I do find this solo is very
sick.
Yeah,
it's
ripping.
It's really cool.
I think like the main hang up I have with fuzz rock is I just don't like the chord progressions.
Yeah, I could.
It's always that like full step and then like a half step to give it that like evil feeling.
Yeah, you know? I know exactly what you mean. It's like
it's a Sabbath effect.
It always has to be sort of inherently doomy or sludgy, and it's like I like it when it's, you know, upbeat and happy and stuff. But yeah, it's always makes it always finds its way in this like that fucking Sty song we heard the other week where like it's cool, it's really different for a while, and then it goes into like a Sabbath riff, you know.
See, guys like me are like, there's no such thing as too much.
That's it.
Praise Iommi, riff lord.
But yeah, this song is sick though. I'm excited to check out the rest of the album because I feel like I could get back into liking Psych.
Yeah, I mean, King Giz is kind of quiet, dude.
Yeah, dude. I'm just kind of enjoying the silence.
Me too. I just triggered a volcano. Somewhere
going to be like somewhere nine albums came unlodged from a mystical mountain. They're rolling down like an avalanche.
Butterfly 3002 is
each
coming.
Album is going to be called like Sorcerer Want Part 1, 2 through 7.
Oh yeah, the worst version of what we want.
This one actually comes with its own tabletop game, and you roll a dice to play a track and just like kill me now.
There's directions on how to listen to the album.
Once you assemble the game, you can listen to the record.
It comes with ankle braces because you're supposed to listen to it upside down.
It's
you
a physical thing.
You can't leave your house unless you listen to the whole thing.
This album comes with sheet music, so you can compose it yourself.
Yeah. Oh, dude, that'd be awesome. Just like a blank vinyl. And like a shitty like Fisher Price microphone. And you have to record the new King Giz album yourself.
We have a revolutionary idea. You're gonna record it yourself.
And it costs $180.
And we're gonna put it all together to make one really shitty album.
That's over 48 days long.
But we're gonna take 2 days to make it.
Put it on Spotify.
Yeah.
That's good. Can love getting a good King Giz riff in there.
Yeah, good King Giz Rogering.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what that means.
I love that. Yeah, I don't know.
Clip that one.
Rogering.
Piss off all the giz heads.
Yeah. I don't know if you went like New Zealand or something. You thought you were saying something.
I thought
Kiwi.
It was a New Zealand, but I think it's British.
My Australian accent.
I don't think
so
it means anything.
Maybe it doesn't.
Maybe it doesn't.
Let's move on. That was Fried 4 by Wine Lips.
All right. This is another one from me. This is Five Finger Death Punch.
Peter.
Dude, you're not good.
X going to give it to you.
This is a track from the deluxe reissue of their 2022 album, Afterlife, featuring none other than...
Wait for it.
DMX.
So X going to give it to you, baby. And he is.
Yeah. I mean, like, I saw this come up on my Spotify, and I was ready to be like, oh, this is going to be terrible. Yeah. And it's kind of good.
It goes a little bit hard,
boys. It doesn't have the five-finger death punch flair to it.
Step back and they let Dog
do his
thing.
It sounds more like a DMX song.
It does.
Yeah. It sounds like something that would be off the soundtrack of Half Past Dead.
It's like
Steven
or like
Skull
Romeo
movie.
Must Die.
Yeah, it's like something crazy.
Butt rock DMX.
Yeah,
a little bit.
Which I can appreciate.
Yeah,
but he has like that aggressive like style that it fits right into butt rock
first
effortlessly.
Off
the red nose rain, dude.
And the last track that we did from Five Finger Death Punch was off of another reissue.
Yeah.
And
Heaven
it was
and Hell Part 3.
Seven.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Are you serious? That's what it was?
It was
Heaven and Hell.
It was definitely
Heaven
and Hell.
They're just reissuing their shit.
Yeah.
Okay.
So. That's what I was going to say, too, is like, I love that Five Finger Death Punch is empty in the vault. Like, we got this six LP. Now, this album came out 2 years ago. We're getting a deluxe reissue.
With DMX.
With DMX. Yeah. I want to talk to Gizheads, who were like real into collecting the vinyls. I was like, you know who else does a lot of sick reissues?
Five Finger Death Punch. Yeah.
And they're actually like a better band too, which is cool.
They don't talk about Wizards.
Just at a bar with like dudes in garage rock bands like, have you guys heard of Five Finger Death Punch? They
just
do
like,
a lot of variants.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like just not even allowing them to separate it at all. Like, no, it's basically the same thing.
The same.
Have you
like
gotten
it.
The rare pressing of Five Finger Death Punch, the Bloody Stool version?
Yeah.
You didn't? Okay,
you're gonna
I
like
have
that
it.
One.
Limited to 1,000 copies. Yeah.
And a lot of people like it.
A lot of people like it.
They're actually probably bigger than King Giz.
They're a little bit
which
bigger.
Which means that they're objectively better.
Yeah. That's what it means.
It's a quadruple LP
and
set.
And we just missed that wild solo.
Yeah, we go back a little bit.
Yeah.
I might have went back too far.
No, this is cool.
Here it is.
I just imagine Dog in the background, just like.
What, I mean, did that, was this a
yeah, I think we should talk about that. He's dead.
He's dead, yeah. And we're talking about it as if, like, he's...
Is that yeah, word? Definitely.
I mean, it's posthumous.
What year did he die?
Like, 2020? Yeah, it was, like, maybe 2021.
Could they have recorded this while he was still alive?
Probably not. Okay. I'm guessing they either were able to get a verse, like, bought a verse that he had already recorded. but what I will say is that we covered a song that they did with Rob Zombie, who is alive.
He is alive.
Yeah. And this sounds much better.
It does sound better.
And is more vital.
Somehow DMX fits in with Five Finger Death much more than Rob Zombie.
A dead DMX is better than an alive Rob Zombie.
Yeah, put that text across the screen. Alive Rob Zombie.
That's so good.
Greater than sign. Yes.
That's so or good.
Whatever, yeah. Less than sign.
It's true.
It is.
It is.
It's true. It's better.
I've listened to this like a dozen times. Yeah. I can't even remember that Rob Zombie song that we covered.
This is the way.
Yeah, he has a weird thing about his voice where it almost sounds like he's inhaling as he's singing.
Yeah, he does like it's one of those.
Yeah,
like it's not. He's not projecting.
No,
he's fucking like Cher.
He's like I don't understand how you do that.
It's a sound guy's nightmare.
It must be some sort of like
technique,
butt rock technique.
Yeah.
Daughtry taught him.
Daughtry.
This is what I did on
my
American
vocal
Idol.
Coach, Daughtry.
Yeah.
Dotch.
Dude, someone on TikTok went after us for making fun of Dotch recently.
Really?
What?
So funny. We had an old clip of us making fun of Dotch. And some guy, I woke up in the morning, like two separate comments.
Oh, let's go.
He unleashed both barrels.
We were saying that he sounds like Imagine Dragons. He's like, you're seriously going to compare Daughtry to Imagine Dragons? Do you even know how much better? I'm like, you are fucking, like, come on, man.
Yeah. How do they like, exist on two separate islands to you?
It's two different planets, dude. I was like, wow, man.
I love that there's, like, a dude out there that's just real rock? Daughtry. Real rock starts on American Idol. Yeah. Okay?
That's where that starts.
Yeah.
You got to start in a competition show.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah. That fake bullshit Imagine Dragons, which was at least a real band at some point.
At least a real band.
Kelly Clarkson didn't get her own talk show for nothing.
Yeah. I got to show you guys those comments. It was so fun.
Oh, my God.
I also stumbled upon a bunch of automatically filtered comments for the sleep token video. And
what's automatically filtered?
I don't know, like that we get them, but they don't show up. And
they're just too offensive that like the pool filter of TikTok is like, whoa.
Whoa, dude. I haven't checked the stats in that video in a while.
Damn.
And then I went and saw that there was like filtered comments. One dude was like, I can't remember what he said, but he called us fat fucks.
Hell yeah, dude. Hell yeah.
He's like, two is a better drummer than you, fat fucks. I was dying. Dude,
that rocks.
So funny. Hard.
We have made it.
So fucking funny.
We have
funny.
So made
oh,
it.
Oh, man. I'll have to show it to you guys after.
Yeah, that's beautiful. All right,
let's move on. That's This Is The Way featuring DMX, Five Finger Death Punch.
Yeah.
Here's a good one, dude.
Next song is my pick. This is a song called Karma by JoJo Siwa. And I went a little investigative reporter on this, like Evan has in the past, because this chick is all that my TikTok feed has been.
Mine too, dude.
It's so bizarre.
Mine too.
There's so many different levels to what's going on here. First of all, I think Nate and I talked about this before you arrived, Evan, but like, this song was written for Miley Cyrus many years ago.
I was going to say, this sounds like a song from 2010.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And JoJo Siwa was claiming as her own, and then people were like, I mean, she bought it, you know?
Yeah.
She was, like, just lying about the fact that she just bought this. And now people have found video of her actually singing, and, I mean, hold on.
I mean, that sound is
it's so old. Yeah.
There's videos that have surfaced of her, like, singing, because she's from Dance Moms. That's where this chick got her
start. Oh, yeah, really?
She's Dance Mom.
She's Abby Lee Miller?
She's a Dance Mom's product. Dude, and she's 20 years old. And this is all a part
of her...
She
recently came out as gay, too.
Have you seen the music video?
I've seen the music
video. This is all part of, like, her very, like, aggressive, forced, and, like, pure cheese rebrand, where she's like, I'm gay now, and then the video is just her kissing chicks, which, like, great, love that. But she's 20. She has a Tesla with her face all over it. She's a very annoying...
She's like the Guy Fieri of, like, little young girls.
She's a very annoying character in, like, the cultural zeitgeist right now.
She's awesome, dude. And there's, like, I love her. I knew nothing about her, but she
rocks.
Cool.
There's this really funny clip, because in this music video, if you haven't seen it, she's rocking straight up, like, Gene Simmons
garb. She's wearing, like...
Because, like, she's supposed
to be... demon?
Yes.
It's like if there was a Blades of Glory 2,
yeah,
and they introduced, like, the anti-Will Ferrell character, and like, they just have, like, a black version
Girl
of that.
Fieri.
But the funny part is, like, so she's, like, bad.
Yeah,
like,
she's bad.
And that's, like, the karma. Karma's a bitch. I should've... Yeah. She's karma. And then someone was, like, interviewing her. There's so many gotcha moments in this saga of, like, she's, like, the interviewer's, like, something like, so, like, notice you, like, really borrowed a lot of style from, like, Gene Simmons and Kiss. And she's like, who's that? I don't know about that. Yeah. You know, that kind of stuff. And it's just so beautiful. And here's the thing. This song, I love this song.
I actually like the song. I do like the song.
All of that into it. I don't care who sings it.
Took a long route to that one.
I like this song.
I think it's cool.
Go ahead.
No, it reminds me of, like, being at Jimmy D's.
Yeah.
Restart it.
Let's just do it again.
It's so good.
It reminds me of being at Jimmy D's in, like, 2010.
Absolutely. Yeah. I would go nuts to this thing.
Yeah.
A few Red Bull vodkas.
Oh, my God.
And I like it even more knowing that Abby Lee Miller has... She's the best.
She's so sick.
Yeah. Like, she's the best job on it. Yeah. I love somebody who's an expert at something that they clearly can't do.
Pirouette!
Like, just screaming at a child to do ballet moves, and it looks like if you broke out into Chesterfield, you'd be in an ICU bed. Fucking amazing.
It's the best.
Dude, like, I was watching a clip
Steven
where she
Seagal
was...
effect.
Like, 100%. She's the Seagal
of
fine
dancing.
Dance. I was watching one where... I don't know if she had an accident or something, but she was in a motorized wheelchair.
Yes, no, it's the best.
Just driving around.
And she just, like, backs... Like, it's like... She goes to, like... She's in some auditorium, and, like, some mother, like, whispers to her something rude, and then she just backs up her wheelchair, like, full the way back. Like, does not turn around. She just backs up in reverse for, like... 20 feet.
Is there like a
It's
beep,
so funny. No.
I'll show it.
It's so funny.
I mean, imagine that your job is to ride around on a motorized wheelchair and tell children that their dreams
that
will never
suck.
Come true.
Yeah, that they're terrible at what they're trying to do.
Your posture's shit. Yeah.
There's like a very strange like dance choreography along
with
this
dancing
song.
Is funny.
It's really funny.
I wonder if she brought in Abby Lee.
She might have,
Well, and like...
For the video.
Yeah, like a lot of people think that it's just a troll job, but like all of this is just bought and manufactured for this chick's rebrand. But she... I'm convinced this girl doesn't know anything about what she's doing. She's just being told...
There's
to do
one,
all of this.
I stumbled down a rabbit hole for JoJo Siwa on TikTok.
I'm
and
down a mega rabbit
there's
hole.
There's another instance of her stealing a song that's even more egregious than this. Did you see it?
Yeah.
Like, well, she's at a club, and she's like, here's another new song that's
my
not out
song.
Yet. She's like, here's another new song I have. And she plays it to this whole club full of people. And it's clearly someone else singing. Like, definitely.
She's
it doesn't
not
even sound like
this.
Yeah, but it does.
Oh, really?
She has a very raspy voice, and there's no rasp in this voice anywhere. Unless it's, like, heavily processed or something.
But the song that she plays, the other song, it doesn't sound even anything like this.
Yeah.
Like, it's definitely someone else's voice. And then people under the comments were like, this was this girl's song that she released 2 years ago, and it's still up on her TikTok. And you go to that girl's TikTok, and it literally is just someone else's song. They didn't change a thing about it.
No, like
they just lived.
Dude,
they bought it and changed nothing.
The version, like the Miley Cyrus version, was then purchased by some other random actress chick. who sang it and put it out, and she has a much better voice than whoever's singing on this. It's out.
Oh, so this song exists? Like
already
in another world?
Yeah, I mean,
with
like
another
eight,
person,
like 8 years ago.
That's so
then,
awesome. I would find that.
JoJo Siwa is just buying.
Do you know
all
who that
this.
Is?
No, but if you go in your TikTok feed for 2 seconds, it's like some blonde chick.
I don't want to do that.
Yeah, but it's there. It's crazy.
I think she needs to bring Abby Lee back in the fold.
Yeah, dude.
Like, you know how she has, like, the Tesla with her face all over? Get, like, Abby Lee in, like, a huge spinner rims on her wheelchair. Just, like, choreography in the wheelchair.
One of those little carts that connects to the car.
Yeah, it's like them, like, riding down, like, the highway. Abby Lee, get out of my way!
Dance Moms is sick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God! This is such an awesome saga. The saga of JoJo Siwa.
It's awesome.
The
sure all the
miniature
dudes
Guy
that,
Fury.
I'm sure all the dudes that yeah, came on that for the Queens of the Stone Age review were like, "I want a 10-minute JoJo Siwa cup."
Unsub.
Yeah.
That's the name of this. That's the name of this episode. Unsub.
Unsubbed. I'm sure we're going to lose about eight. We're going to lose 9 followers, bringing us back to
some heavy attrition.
I did some very heavy investigative journalism for that.
Yeah.
By that, I mean scroll on TikTok for 10
minutes. Yeah, I mean, it was all right in my face. Everywhere. I couldn't get away from it.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It rocks, though. All right, that's JoJo Siwa.
I do like
Karma.
That song.
It's good. I think it's good. I mean, it was written by a fucking professional songwriter.
Bangs. Yeah.
Damn it.
He has a hot one for you.
Yeah, his own. I'm going to sell it to 4 different people and let them figure it out.
They'll figure it out.
It's going to be a bidding war. For this
people
song.
Are going to go nuts
over
for
the
this
span
song.
Of 15 yeah. years. The girl that's going to
legendary.
The girl that's going to own it's not even born yet.
She's not even going to be born yet. That's so sick. Just the dude from that fucking Andrew Garfield movie,
I'm
the songwriter. Yeah,
yeah. Under the Silver Lake.
Yeah, that's such a sick
I'm
scene.
Doing the mom from Bob's Burgers.
I knew I played this one, too. He starts playing Smells Like Teen
Bobby.
Spirit. Andrew Garfield's like, no.
No. Yeah. That movie rules.
Like, you didn't know I did this one, did you? It's such a heartbreaking scene.
Yeah. Bobby, I wrote comma for JoJo Siwa.
You didn't know I did this one, too.
Comma's a bitch.
Comma's a bitch. Yeah. Fucking
didn't
Benedict
know you
Tinister
could be
wrote
such
that
a
one.
Bitch.
Yeah. Let's move on. Right. This is a pick that I just added today. Because the song came out yesterday, and I've been like dying to talk about this band. We may have talked about them on like the first episode of the show because that's when
I think they came up at some point.
Their first album came out in 2022. They're a band called Wunderhorse. The song is called Midas. But they had an album in 2022 called Cub, which is like I think it's like very underrated. They have some Springsteen vibes, but Cub also had some like weird rock, like post-punk vibes that I liked a lot. That album just, I'm surprised I didn't hear more about it, but I've been seeing more about this band. I was waiting for them to put out a new song or announce a new album, and here it is. I'm like slightly underwhelmed by the song because
really?
It's like, it's just very bare bones. I don't know, but like, love the melody.
And I love the lyrics.
I like the lyrics a lot.
Like, his delivery is very cool.
He's got a sick voice.
Yeah, because you sent me Leader of the Pack.
Yeah, Leader of the Pack's a great song.
And I listened to, like, the EP that all those songs were on. They all ended up on Cub, though, right?
I think so,
yeah.
Yeah.
So I'd never listened to Cub, but I remember really liking that EP. And, they have, like, a strange, like, it's rootsy Americana mixed with, like, indie rock.
It makes me think that maybe I don't like Bruce Springsteen just because he's an old fuck.
Well, no, you don't because you like fucking what's his name?
You know what I mean?
Yeah, 100%.
Like, it's just like I hear stuff like this and I'm like, hell, this rules. And it's like, it's just Bruce Springsteen. Like, it sounds like Bruce Springsteen.
It's like less raspy Bruce.
Yeah. It's like, do I just not like it because it's not cool? Like,
yeah.
It's not like this is cool, but like, it is very similar to Springsteen.
That was
you're saying if Bruce gained some sort of late career indie cred. I mean, that would bring a lot more Chads on board.
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, it has to do with his entire career.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, like,
no, I mean, that was always my aversion until we did that podcast episode. Right. Like, I think we even talked about it.
Yeah, we did.
Like, he is the antithesis of the guy in the AC/DC shirt. Right, where you're just like, that shit's lame.
Yeah, exactly.
My shit's cool.
Exactly.
Yeah. But right. I've turned around.
Yeah, I kind of have too.
We're Bottle Rock, and they played that live video of 10th Avenue Freeze Out. Yeah, and it's just like insane.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah.
But yeah, I think I like this song a lot. It's cool just to hear a fucking just a fucking rock band.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like that's just what this band is. They're just a rock band. The song doesn't have much going on. There's not like crazy guitar parts or synth or anything, or you know, it's just fucking, it sounds like a live recording.
You can just call it rock, and that's fine.
It's just rock.
Because, like, there's so many fucking post-grunge fucking whatever subset of rock.
It's just rock.
That's probably just what that is.
But I think it, like, it's, it also has the immediacy of, like, rock.
Yeah.
You know, like, there's a lot of, like, rock genres that go into, like, deep into whatever, like, style or aesthetic.
Yeah.
And they lose that thing that feels like this had to be birthed.
Yeah.
You know, whereas, like, you hear that song and you're like, damn.
Someone fucking wrote this in, like, a bedroom. You know what
exactly.
I mean? I want them to just get bigger. I would like to fucking see this band. I think I saw a TikTok about them last night. Someone was like, you know, you should listen to this band. They're underrated. So they could be on a come up. You know, we could see more of them.
Well, now they just got the IQMB.
They got
bump.
The IQMB seal of approval.
Yeah.
All the, you know, all of our subs are gonna hear this.
Minus the eight. That leave.
But yeah, that's Wunderhorse with Midas. Good ass shit from Wunderhorse. Let's move on.
This is a pick from me. This is Hobo Johnson with the song Metaverse.
What's this guy's deal?
They came onto the scene in like 2018. They had like a viral video of them performing a song called Peach Scone in like a backyard. And it was, remember when like Tiny Desk, I don't know if they still do it, but like they had a contest to get on to Tiny Desk.
Was it like a COVID thing?
No.
No, before that.
But it was just like if you wanted to get on to Tiny Desk, you could make a video. And it like blew up, I think on Reddit or something like that.
Yeah.
And from the inception, I found them extremely annoying.
Yeah. Everyone has been making fun of that video, right?
Oh, yeah?
Like, it's the one where they're like in the room, and it's like, "Hi, hey, is that what you're talking about?"
Yeah. It's like, "Hello,
how you doing?" And it's like immediately annoying. Yeah, people make fun of that all the time. I can't even watch that.
Yeah,
like it's painful to watch.
This was the song on the playlist that like, the anxiety it fills me with.
Just the
horn blast.
Yeah,
the like bong rip, slam poetry.
Yeah, the
vocal.
Slam poetry is just the worst.
And the like, the content of it, like it's supposed to be like social commentary about metaverse, but. Is the metaverse even a thing anymore?
No.
I've never met one human being that has spent a second in the metaverse.
People, there was a few things in the recent years that like people just went, you know, and I love that. Like the metaverse, like NFTs.
Yeah.
People were just like, you know what? That's really fucking dumb. And no. You know what I mean?
It gives you some hope for the future.
People are just like I don't
Zuckerberg
think so.
Dumped billions behind it. It's like it's a whole virtual world. And people are like, I'm good. I'll take this regular hell world that you helped create.
Yeah.
So I mean, like none of this like feels like it lands.
Yeah,
like
it's late.
It doesn't feel prescient. Because when he's like talking about like, can you imagine anything worse? I'm like, nobody's there.
No, I don't even know what the fuck it is.
Yeah.
It just seems like a thing that failed.
Yeah, like it should be dunking on him for how poorly.
Yeah, it should be. Yeah, I mean, I will say this. I thought it was, since I saw that Hobo Johnson video and saw them in the fucking Tiny Desk thing doing that like weirdo like how's it going? Like shy, like stage performance.
Yeah,
like
both
weird, uncomfortable.
Shy and a person that like you would start a conversation with and be like, I can't get out.
It's gotta be over.
I have to leave this.
But
right
they
now.
Keep like yeah, they cornering keep,
yeah. But telling you just about their life.
Yeah, like, you're being talked at.
You're like, that's cool, man. And they're just like, And I'm also working on this.
Is this a band or an individual?
It's a band, but I think he is like Hobo Jones.
Oh, okay.
Gotcha. I don't know.
With a backing band or something?
I don't know.
All right. Yeah, it was very it got my blood pressure up.
Yeah.
I honestly, unlistenable.
I honestly didn't hate the instrumental, I'll be honest.
The other song that I've heard from them too does have a decent instrumental. Yeah. It's like stripped down, minimalist.
Yeah. It reminded me of like the Gorillaz, except way messier and feeling like scatterbrained. I mean, the thing I hated about it the most were the delivery of the vocals and the lyrics.
The subject matter is so stupid.
Yeah. Can you imagine something worse? Yeah. I hate that spoken word.
And
annoying.
How obvious everything is. Like, there's no poetry. It's just stating.
And then
the end, when they're just screaming metaverse,
it's rough.
Terrible.
It sucks.
Sorry, guys.
I mean, we got to put it on.
Yeah,
we never talked about Hobo Johnson before.
Duty calls. I mean,
yeah, duty call. We should dig into Hobo Johnson a little bit more.
HBJ,
Peach
dude.
Scone. Wait, hold on. I want to just hear a little bit of Peach Scone.
Yeah, that's enough.
Like, immediately, I'm just like, fuck you.
It's immediately
for
annoying.
For even putting this out.
It's immediately annoying.
Yeah, awful.
Just that, like, it's hard to put your finger on, but you know that type of personality.
Yeah, yeah.
Where it's like the guy in a fedora who is, like, the funniest guy in his friend group, and then he's outside of that
and
ecosystem, and you're just like, stop, bro.
Yeah. Yeah. Or someone who you see out, and you, see on, like, their social, and you think they're very cool.
Yeah.
And then the first time you talk to them, you're like,
fuck.
It's the worst person I've ever met in my life. Yeah. I hate that guy.
Yeah.
Like, that happens so often.
Oh, no, I've definitely had that.
You're like, sorry. Oh, I want to meet that dude. He seems cool. And you're like, let's move on.
Never meet your heroes.
Yeah, exactly.
Speaking of, dude.
This is it. Like an old school. I mean, these are some old ass dudes.
Yeah.
This is a band called Fear, and this is their song off their new release. The song's called Astronomy Domine, whatever. And like every time I add a song like this to the playlist, it's always like my quest. It's either like a bad bitch tune. Or like, wow, have you ever heard somebody sound so old?
I was just gonna say.
Or like,
you've done this a couple times.
Or if we find like a good, we're fucked.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, there's like a few
fits
categories.
Into the categories.
It's a revolving door. Yeah.
So like this is like with the Fog Hats of the world, or Bon Jovi,
Fogey Patrol, 100%.
Fogey Patrol,
the Soft Penis Brigade,
the SPB, but these guys firmly fit into that. Get it firm
penis.
The production's so bad.
Yeah, it's
like
bad.
It's could all be garage band stock music. Like, like, it's shameful that they spent money to record actual instruments, like I'm sure that they did.
Yeah,
because this is just like stock sounds from like you could make this on
this is insane.
I mean, it's so sick. I mean, Fear was like, they were like a hardcore,
legendary
hardcore band. And they have six songs. So I was surprised to hear this like slow, like very lame.
And like, you know, it's just like after a certain point, it's like when you're an old guy band, there's no way for your voice not to sound like you're an old guy.
Yeah.
That's why you have to do like the Johnny Cash thing. Where where you just make songs about dying.
Yeah.
Well, leaving from... That's the dude's name from Fear, Lee Ving. He always looked and sounded old. Like, even if you, like, listen to, like, one of their, you know, like, listen to their top song, Give Me Some Action. Like, he even had, like... He probably was 22 at the time, but he sounds like 50.
Is that the same band?
It's not the same.
No,
it's different.
This is out of all the like Fogey Patrol bands that we've covered, one is the one that hurts.
I'm not
necessarily like a huge Fear guy, but they were in Fall of Western Civilization.
Yeah, that's how I know that.
And they're also the first punk band ever to play SNL.
Yeah. Didn't they get kicked off? And
well, there's a famous story where like Belushi was doing a guest appearance, and he was like really was into the LA punk rock scene, So he would only agree if they let Fear play, And then Lorne Michaels calls Ian MacKaye down in DC, and is like, "Hey, I need you to bring up like 30 real punks into the audience because Belushi doesn't want them to play in front of like normies that, from like Nebraska coming in to watch SNL. And he's like, what are you talking about? Yeah. He's like, hold on. Gives the phone to Belushi and he's like, hey, I need you to, and like just reiterates. Yeah. He's like, okay, I guess it's really happening.
Yeah.
So they bring up like, they end up bringing like 80 punks from DC.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is.
And they destroy the studio.
Yeah.
Like first day at dress rehearsal, they broke like a $100,000 camera. And there's like, if you watch the clip, the mic falls into the stands and Ian MacKay grabs it and just goes, New York stinks. So that's that band who like broke all this ground is like the demons of the night.
That does suck.
Yeah, it's so
like
bad.
You just gotta quit after that SNL appearance. You're just like it's over. That's the coolest thing.
We say
ever.
That now, but in 40 years and we're still behind these mics and we're just like, actually,
we're gonna get to 500. We still aren't there.
We're still not at 500.
This new JoJo Siwa song really spoke to me.
432.
King Gizzard's 797 albums. Best yet.
It's his best. It's their best one.
I want to expire in this chair. Just mid-episode, just like.
Just in the middle of listening to a King Gizzard album, just. It's like trying to say something.
I'm like,
this is your last breath.
Really? The dude from Vegas Vacation. It's like, I die. You pause for like another 20 minutes. Yeah. And I'm just like. It sucks.
Your brain just stops working.
You know, the subject matter
my last
in this song
breath
is not that.
My last breath is trying to get out an insult about Imagine Dragons.
Did I ever say they're like a Linkin Park of a mega church?
That's so funny.
Oh, that's good.
That shout out
good.
To Fear.
Shout out to Fear.
You guys don't have it anymore,
keep
but
going.
Whatever.
Let's move
keep
on.
Going.
Here's what I put on. Oh, fuck.
Oh, Jesus.
That's the first
Christ.
Time that's ever happened on this
keep
show.
Keep it in.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Ugh. We're going to keep that, right?
Please don't.
We'll just go back. Yeah, I put this one on. I sort of wanted to have a larger discussion about something with this song. First of all, it's called Sliding Doors by a band called Boston Manor. Showed up on one of my, like, you know, one of the Spotify playlists that they make, like, rock this. And it was, like, the top song. But it's not bad, but it sounds exactly like Deftones.
Yeah. See, I was getting
exactly.
See, I was getting the other way. Like, there's three different songs or three different bands. I think this sounds like Deftones.
I think the beginning is like this is a dead ringer for White Pony era Deftones. Like even that guitar tone.
I can hear that, but the riff it goes into after it sounds exactly like Bulls on Parade to me.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Wait, let me hear that real quick.
It's like a. Three vibes smashed
it's
together.
It's kind of like a grab bag.
I mean,
bag.
The vocal is a. Chino Moreno, Deftones vocal. The guitar sounds like White Pony, Deftones.
Right here.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it is.
And then later in the song, it sounds like Tool. They go into
a
weird,
bit.
With a hi-hat. And then there's a couple parts where it sounds like Limp Bizkit.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple. I mean, it has like that metalcore vocal there, too. But yeah, it just, it makes, I feel like I've been hearing so many bands recently sound exactly like Deftones. Like,
maybe people were thinking that nobody remembers Deftones.
Maybe.
And pulling
but
a fast
like,
one.
There's a band called Loathe that are pretty good, but they sound exactly like Deftones. And I remember like tweeting a while ago, like maybe a year or two ago, like, why does every band sound like Deftones now? And someone replied to me and was like, because Deftones are awesome. And I was like, is Deftones, like, were they ever a thing that people, like, really... I love Deftones.
They're, like, by far, my cousin played in bands and stuff and was, like, largely influential in me playing in bands, whatever. They're, like, his favorite band by, like, a long shot. Like, them and Every Time I Die and then everything else. And
I think
I think they're, like, having a moment.
It Deftones. Seems like they are.
Yeah, I think that their vibe kind of fits today more than it fit 1998.
It's
yeah.
really strange that it is. Like, there's so many bands that are just lifting fucking Deftones.
I feel like it, like, 6-7 years ago, if you were like, yeah, I mean, I love Deftones, people would be like,
yeah, what? Yeah, it's like, what?
Like, now it's kind like, of like cool. that, and Limp Bizkit yeah. and Creed are all like, oh.
Don't lump Creed in. You can't just grab Creed, yeah. Creed and be and like, Creed? And also Creed's
also
great.
Also Creed here, yeah.
All right, fine. Limp Bizkit, Nickelback. Whatever. I'm just saying, yeah, like,
I know
shit
what you
that,
mean.
Shit that, like, was yeah. super, like,
I would say like more
uncool.
System of a Down.
Yeah, down. New metal. New metal is shit.
Yeah, I think people are going back. This is the Tool part.
Yeah, this is Tool's.
Yeah,
fun.
I can. I mean, it still sounds like Deftones. Yeah, to me. I mean, I'm a big Deftones fan, so this whole song was just like, I feel like I can trace it back to any.
Like, this sounds like Limp Bizkit to me. Like, literally break stuff.
Wait, let me hear this riff again.
Literally break stuff.
Oh yeah, it is. That's the riff to Break Stuff.
Yeah.
Dude, this band just went just shopping cart.
Yeah, dude, they went on the Family Values Tour sampler pack that came with the T-shirt. Yeah. It was like, a little here, a
little
here.
A little
here.
That, a little
I'm not mad at it.
It's, no, I think this is a cool song. It's just,
a cool song.
It just makes me think, like, it's kind of the same discussion we had with the Jack Antonoff, Bruce Springsteen thing, where it's like, why are we not having the conversations about bands, you know, pretty blatantly lifting an influence and, like, you know, putting it, I mean, we've heard, like, that song was just basically like three other bands put together, you know, verbatim almost.
Yeah.
So, like, I just, what's the I don't understand why people don't give this kind of thing shit.
I don't think, I think that, like, we're at a place creatively where I don't know if we've given up on original or we just don't value
don't
it as much anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, stoner rock has been
that
doing
be
that
it.
For longer than anything else.
That's
and it's like my
that's
favorite
very
genre.
True. That's very
and
true.
Nobody gives them shit because everyone in that chunk loves it, so who cares?
Yeah.
You just want more. I think people just want more of stuff. And yeah, Bruce isn't making any new music or whatever. Deftones isn't making new music. So if this band sounds like them, that's cool. Like,
it's really
interesting. That's kind of Greta Van Fleet, too. It's
that's
like,
what I'm
we
saying.
We want more Zeppelin.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's a Greta Van Fleet thing. And people gave them so much shit for sounding exactly like Zeppelin. And it's like, there are so many bands that are doing it more today than I feel like ever.
Yeah, and I don't know if part of that has to do with, like, the like greater breakdown of this idea of monoculture that everybody is kind of siloed away into like their interests.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, in like the 90s, if you were going to be a big band, you had to hit this like giant swath of like the American public.
The internet probably has a lot to do with it.
Yeah, 100%. Sure. Like everything's like fractured and all over the place. Yeah. So there are people who are just like, I love nu metal. And there's a band that
sounds like
just like 1999.
My favorite nu metal band. Yeah.
I feel like it's not as, I'm forgetting the word, but it's like not as like, whatever for like any music that anybody's into anymore.
No that like that shame of like selling out or being unoriginal, it doesn't
anymore.
Exist
I just all I feel I take issue with it like more than any I feel like I get bothered by it more than anything. I don't know why.
Well,
like,
I think that,
selling out
not selling out, just a band sounding exactly like another band.
Like you don't like it.
It's not that I don't like it. Like I listened to bands like Loathe and thought like, wow, that's really cool. But it's like distracting. I feel like it's a distraction. Like the only thing I really take away from listening to this song is just like, if I'm gonna tell you about it, I'm gonna go, it sounds
like
exactly
Deftones.
Like Deftones.
Yeah.
Like that's the only thing I really have to say.
That makes sense.
You know? Does that make sense?
Yeah,
like,
I got
a distracting thing. I don't
I got
know.
It.
I mean, I get that no one really cares about it anymore, but maybe I shouldn't. Maybe I should just chill.
No, dude, that's why
maybe
you have this platform.
I know, this
like,
is what we started this
say it with
shit.
This
chest.
Shit sounds like Deftones!
No one's listening to me!
You had to 408 people from your basement. That's why we kicked the British out of this fucking country.
Yeah, that's
right. It's true.
Yeah. That's why we dumped all the tea into that harbor. Dude.
Yeah, dude.
Stand up for what we believe.
Yeah, so that I can scream my opinions into a void.
About some band who has no idea this podcast exists or is going to care.
Yeah.
Shout out Boston Manor. Keep sounding like Deftones.
Hell
keep
yeah.
doing your thing.
I actually did kind of like the song.
The song is cool.
I like the rage part the most. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The song is cool. Let's move on.
This is my last pick. This is Pedro the Lion with a song called Modesto. It's a single off their upcoming album Santa Cruz, which is due out in June. Pedro the Lion is a band that I've listened to from time to time. I'm not like a huge fan of. I find them interesting. They were like a Christian indie rock band in the early 2000s.
Damn.
Yeah, dude.
That's something that I just go, oh, boy.
But like they were able to do it in like a tasteful way. Like I have a buddy who grew up in like a very Christian, like non-denominational church type of deal. And this was like his all-time favorite band.
Interesting.
They have an album from 2002 called Control, which is like a cult classic.
Yeah.
And it is a really good record.
Yeah.
And if you would have told me it was like a Christian rock band, I'd be like, really?
Yeah.
You know? But I think he has since like not Christian. Like, okay. Like I don't think he leans on that anymore. And they broke up in like 2004, and the main songwriter, David Bazan, I think is how you pronounce it, or Bazan, he was making solo records, and like 15 years after the breakup of Pedro the Lion, he like resurrected the band and started releasing music again in like 2019. But I think he was always just him, so it was like he was doing solo shit for a while, and it was like, Pedro the Lion's back, brothers.
Yeah.
But I dig the song. I think it's like it's a different kind of sound for them. I can't really put my finger on it. It's like more nostalgic.
It reminded me of like a Sun Kill Moon or Mark Kozelik song, except with like a backing instrumentation that's not just like classical guitar and that like really can get on your nerves after a while. Yeah. Like he sounds a little like he reminds me of Mark Kozelik. And I'm probably only saying that because that's like my really only reference.
No, and the lyrical approach is
the
similar
lyrical
too.
Approach I thought too. Like the storytelling parts of it, but it's very lazy. It feels like you're walking through sand listening to the song, but like not in a bad way. It's like kind of reminds you to slow down a bit. That's how I felt about it.
If Evan is going to get down with a ballad, this is the kind of ballad that he gets down with.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it checks all the other boxes that I know that Evan likes. And it's like jangly guitars, monotone dude singing.
Sad dude.
And then usually it's a little bit more upbeat and frantic, but then you're going to throw a ballad on it, and that's what this is.
Yeah.
You know, 1+1+1. Yeah. You get this.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the like synth freak out at the end.
That was cool.
I was reading that apparently that's like a Granddaddy reference. You know the band Granddaddy?
Granddaddy.
Oh. Like he talks about getting a tape at some point.
I've only heard a few Granddaddy songs.
Granddaddy's sick.
They're cool, from what I heard. But yeah, I like this. I thought that it was cool.
Yeah,
it's cool.
It's Modesto by Pedro the Lion. Whenever they came back, I remember I always got them mixed up with Judah and the Lion, which is like a band that gets played on the radio like back to back with Imagine Dragons.
I used to do that to my friend who loves Pedro the Lion. Yeah. I was like, they got a new song out, right? And he's like, no.
It's not that.
They haven't existed for a decade. Idiot.
Judah the Lion sounds way more like a Christian band than Pedro.
I'm pretty sure Judah and the Lion are they Christian band? I think they might be.
Judah
and the Lion.
I don't know. But
Christian bands,
like
they really sneak the Christian thing in. You don't know about it until you Wikipedia.
Well, there's two lanes. Yeah. There's like the lane where it's like they actually play in churches where it's just like straight. And then there's the sleeper cells. Where they're like a little cooler. And then like they like, you know, like the Mission Impossible mask. And he's like, can I tell you about the Lord?
And then you go to their Wikipedia page and there's always a section that's like personal, you know.
Personal beliefs. Yeah.
And then it's like, they haven't confirmed that they're a Christian band, but their lyrics always mention something about Jesus. Their lead singer, and the quote is always like, we just love our faith in the Lord.
Yeah.
But that it doesn't have anything to do with our music.
I think it's
and then their next album is like the Bible.
Part three.
It's a very funny business decision for like a, you know, a Christian band that's fronting as like a we're just normal to like be very guarded about it. Mm-hmm. And then you get a little taste and you're like, hey, we're all about this.
We're Christian.
Can we come to your church?
Yeah. I had no idea that band Flyleaf was a Christian band.
Really? That's awesome. That? I didn't know that.
Flyleaf.
Dude, cool. I had no idea.
The song have that All song Around sick. Me. You know, All Around Me? It's about about Jesus.
Dude, that rules. I think more bands
She's like just... she's like a fucking She's like a bad Christian. She's one of the like Westboro Baptist Church.
Are you really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They like kicked her out for a while. I think she's back in. The
Flyleaf
band.
Is sick, right? I'm so sick.
I think so. I only know All Around
That
me.
Song's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, about Jesus.
Yeah, that's a rough. Any church that asks you to hold a sign, get out of that church.
That's tough.
I can feel you. That's a good song, man. You just can't. I can't get over it. All right, Pedro the Lion, Modesto.
Mm-hmm.
Let's move on to the last song.
Yeah, this is the last song.
A JJ classic.
A JJ classic. I actually, this was a last minute of dish because I found this via my bandmates, actually, weirdly enough. Like, did you hear the new Kim Petras album? And I'm like, no. And they're like, I recommend Rim Job, which is what this song is called. And I listened to it. And Kim Petras rose to fame, kind of, sort of, through Sam Smith's
Auto
song.
Auto Body or whatever it's called.
Huh? The Unholy.
Unholy.
Unholy. Oh.
What did
the
you
Body
call it?
Shop.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Body Shop.
Oh,
song,
yeah. I said Auto Body.
The Auto Body.
She rose to fame because she had a feature on the Unholy song with Sam Smith. And I think this is her first full-length release or
is
something.
Is it really?
I don't
think
know.
So.
Maybe not.
It's
maybe
called, like, Miami Slut.
Slut Pop Miami.
So, Hell yeah.
Sick
Miami.
Song. It's like, you
can
know,
I read you
Miami
some,
Vice.
Can I read you some of these song titles for
yeah,
you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, second song in is Gag On It, Banana Boat, Butt Slut.
Butt Slut. I like that.
What Whale Cock. And then the last song is just called Can We Fuck?
Mm-hmm.
Nice. And
I like how we've gotten to the point where... Like in Spinal Tap, they would have like names like that, and it was like,
"We're just gonna do it now."
Yeah, exactly. And it's going to be actually mainstream pop music.
What, I like that in 2022 she has an album called Slut Pop, and that now it's Slut Pop
Miami.
Yeah, that's dude. That's sick.
So
I hope her next one's Slut Pop San Andreas.
Yeah.
Yes.
Though you know, I'm a pretty open-minded guy. But, like, reading these lyrics, I'm kind of like, I kind of feel like my mom. I'm like, ooh.
Yeah.
Yikes.
I don't know, dude. Kind of made me want to get a rim job.
Don't act surprised when I'm kissing on your thighs. He was a virgin. Now he wanted all the time.
Yeah.
I'm kind of just like, ooh.
Yeah. He wasn't sure.
No,
now
no, that's the correct reaction to have.
Yeah.
Like,
a
like,
classic
it makes
Tucker
me feel
Carlson.
Really conservative. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
Do I want a rim job?
No,
I think I do.
It's less like the moral destruction
of
it all.
Yeah,
it's just the
Ooh.
Crass lack of artistic ability to like.
It's like,
if, like, you know, like even like Love Gun was like crass
Love
back
Gun
then. Is. And now it's just like, how about I stick my tongue in your ass? Why don't
and
I
you're
do
gonna
that?
Love it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's, I mean, that's exactly it. It's like. Porn.
Yeah, it's porn
music.
Yeah.
Can we go back a little bit?
Yeah
I just want to hear it more.
He sing a ballad while I'm tossing his salad.
That was the only part that I was like, you know what? That little turn of phrase was nice.
Phallus.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the creative bankruptcy is really is what gets me of the song.
Touching his phallus, now he's horny like a rabbit. I know the chalice, I'm the queen of the palace.
Yeah.
I mean, it's beautiful.
I just can't
this.
Wait to just blast this song in my car, windows down.
When we're in Austin.
Just, yeah, exactly. Yeah, in Austin, wearing cowboy hats.
Yeah.
Slut Pop Austin.
Slut Pop Austin.
What?
Bachelor Party
edition. Dude. I'm Stone Cold Slut Austin.
Yeah.
What
are you going to do? You're going to eat my ass. Yeah. Which one of you is going to eat my ass?
Yeah. Anybody want
to
eat my ass?
Who
give me a
hell
yeah. It's like the vest with nothing
Who wants
else.
To toss my salad?
Just walking down, leather vest,
his cock
goatee, out. Just
like Winnie the Pooh.
Yeah,
just,
dude.
It's like his dick. Is just
Hell yeah. So
Who wants to eat my ass?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's hilarious. Oh,
yeah.
Sub Pop Miami. That's such rim a job, sick album title.
Rim Job by Kim Petras. Yeah. Shouts to Kim Petras.
Shouts to Kim Petras. That's cool. She's got Slut Pop Miami shorts. I'm about to get into the merch game here, brother. Dude. Get a little pair of shorts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love it. Mm-hmm. Well, everyone, thanks for watching the show. Go listen to Slut Pop Miami.
Yeah. That's all you need to listen
That's all you need to listen to. But thanks, everyone, for watching. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't yet. Leave a comment. Leave a like. Follow us on Instagram, TikTok, Patreon, and listen on Spotify if you prefer it that way. But, yeah, thanks. It's I Quit My Band. We'll see you next time.